The following is a free-for-download audiobook available on krishnapath.org. Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhyalila, Chapter 15. The Lord Accepts Prasad at the House of Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya. The following summary of this chapter is given by Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur in his Amrita Prabhava Bhasya. After the Rath Yatra festival, Sri Advaita Acharya Prabhu worshipped Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu with flowers and tulsi. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, in turn, worshipped Advaita Acharya with flowers and tulsi that remained on the offered plate and said a mantra, Yo si soshi, what you are, end quote. Then Advaita Acharya Prabhu invited Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu for prasad. When Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his devotees performed the Nandotsava ceremony, the Lord personally dressed himself as a cowherd boy. Thus, the ceremony was very jubilant. Then the Lord and his devotees observed the Vijaya Dasami, the day of victory when Lord Ramchandra conquered Lanka. The devotees all became soldiers of Lord Ramchandra, and Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, in the ecstasy of Hanuman, manifested various transcendentally blissful activities. Thereafter, the Lord and his devotees observed various other ceremonies. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu then asked all the devotees to return to Bengal. Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu sent Nityananda Prabhu to Bengal for preaching and also sent Ramdas, Gadadhar Das, and several other devotees with him. Then Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, with great humility, sent some Jagannath Prasad and a cloth made from Lord Jagannath to his mother through Shivas Thakur. When the Lord bade farewell to Raghava Pandit, Vasudev Dat, the residents of Kunila Gram, and other devotees, he praised them for their transcendental qualities. Ramananda Vasu and Satyaraj Khan asked some questions, and Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu instructed them that all householder devotees must engage themselves in the service of Vaishnavas, exclusively devoted to chanting the holy name of the Lord. He also directed the devotees from Khanda, instructed Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya and Vidya Vishapati, and praised Murari Gupta for his firm faith in the lotus feet of Lord Ramchandra. Considering the humble prayer of Vasudev Dat, he established that Lord Sri Krishna is qualified to deliver all the conditioned souls. Thereafter, when Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was accepting prasad at the house of Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, Sarvabhauma's son-in-law, Amoga, created trouble within the family with his criticisms. The following morning, he was attacked by the disease of Visochita cholera. Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu very kindly saved him from death and enlivened him in chanting the holy name of Lord Krishna. Text 1. While Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was accepting prasad at the house of Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, Amoga criticized him. At that time, the Lord also showed how much he was obliged to his devotees. Text 2. All glories to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, all glories to Lord Nityananda Prabhu, all glories to Advaita Chandra, and all glories to all the devotees of Lord Chaitanya. Text 3. All glories to the listeners of Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita who have accepted it as their life and soul. Text 4. While Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu stayed at Jagannath Puri, he constantly enjoyed chanting and dancing with his devotees. Text 5. In the beginning, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu saw the deity of Lord Jagannath in the temple. He offered him obeisances and prayers and danced and sang before him. Text 6. After visiting the temple, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would remain outside during the Upalaboga offering. He would then go meet Haridas Thakur and return to his residence. Purport. At noon, when there was an Upalaboga offering in a place called Bhoga Vardhana Kanda, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would go outside the temple. Before going outside, he used to stand near the Garuda Stambha column and offer his obeisances and prayers. Afterwards, the Lord would visit Siddha Bakul, where Haridas Thakur lived. After visiting with Haridas Thakur, the Lord would return to his own place at the abode of Kashi Mishra. Text 7. Sitting in his room, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would chant on his beads, and Advaita Prabhu would come there to worship the Lord. Text 8. While worshipping Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Advaita Acharya would offer him scented water to wash his mouth and feet. Then Advaita Acharya would smear very fragrant sandalwood pulp all over his body. Text 9. Sri Advaita Prabhu would also place a flower garland around the Lord's neck and tulsi flowers, manjaris, on his head. Then, with folded hands, Advaita Acharya would offer obeisances and prayers to the Lord. Text 10. After being worshipped by Advaita Acharya, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would take the dish containing flowers and tulsi, and with whatever paraphernalia remained, would also worship Advaita Acharya. Text 11. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would worship Advaita Acharya by chanting the mantra, quote, "Whatever you are, but offer my respects unto you," end quote. In addition, the Lord would make some sounds within his mouth that would make Advaita Acharya laugh. Text 12. In this way, both Advaita Acharya and Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would offer their respectful obeisances to one another. Then Advaita Acharya would extend invitations to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu again and again. Text 13. Indeed, Sri Advaita Acharya's invitation is another wonderful story. It has been very vividly described by Vrindavan Das Thakur. Text 14. Since Advaita Acharya's invitation has been described by Vrindavan Das Thakur, I shall not repeat the story. However, I shall say that other devotees also extended invitations to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Text 15. Every day, one devotee after another would invite Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and the other devotees to lunch and also would also hold a festival. Text 16. All the devotees remained at Jagannath Puri for 4 continuous months, and they observed all Lord Jagannath's festivals with great pleasure. Text 17. The devotees also celebrated the festival of Janmashtami, Krishna's birthday, which is also called Nanda Mahotsava, the festival of Nanda Maharaj. At that time, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his devotees dressed themselves as cowherd boys. Text 18. Having dressed up like cowherd boys, all the devotees carried pots of milk and yogurt balanced on rods over their shoulders. Thus they all arrived at the festival grounds chanting the holy name of Hari. Text 19. Kanani Kutiya dressed himself like Nanda Maharaj and Jagannath Mahati dressed himself as Mother Yashoda. Text 20. At that time, King Pratapurudra was also personally present with Kashimisha, Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, and Tulsi Pradichapatra. Text 21. As usual, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu danced jubilantly. Everyone was covered with milk, yogurt, and yellow turmeric water. Text 22. It was at this time that Srila Advaita Acharya said, quote, "Please do not be angry. I speak the truth. I shall know whether you are a cowherd boy only if you can wheel this rod about," end quote. Text 23. Accepting Advaita Acharya's challenge, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu took a big rod and began to wheel it around and around. Again and again, he threw the rod into the sky and caught it when it fell. Text 24. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu wheeled and threw the rod, sometimes over his head, sometimes behind his back, sometimes in front of him, sometimes to his side, and sometimes between his legs. Indeed, all the people laughed to see this. Text 25. When Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu whirled the rod in a circle like a firebrand, the heart of everyone who saw it was astonished. Text 26. Nityananda Prabhu also played at whirling the rod. Who can understand how they were ecstatically immersed in the deep emotions of the cowherd boys? Text 27. Following the orders of Maharaj Pratapurudra, the temple superintendent named Tulsi brought one of Lord Jagannath's used cloths. Text 28. This valuable cloth was wrapped around the head of Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. The other devotees headed by Advaita Acharya also had cloths wrapped about their heads. Text 29. In ecstasy, Kanani Kutiya, who was dressed as Nanda Maharaj, and Jagannath Mahati, who was dressed as Mother Yashoda, distributed all the riches they had stocked at home. text 30. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was greatly satisfied to see this. Accepting them both as his father and mother, he offered them obeisances. Text 31. In great ecstasy, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu returned to his residence. In this way, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who is known as Gauranga Sundara, performed various pastimes. Text 32. On the victory day celebrating the conquest of Lanka, a day known as Vijayadashami, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu dressed up all his devotees like monkey soldiers. Text 33. Displaying the emotions of Hanuman, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu took up a large tree branch and, mounting the walls of the Lanka fort, began to dismantle it. Text 34. In the ecstasy of Hanuman, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu angrily said, quote, "Where is the rascal Ravana? He has kidnapped the universal mother, Sita. Now I shall kill him and all his family." End quote. Text 35. Everyone became very astonished to see the emotional ecstasy of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and everyone began to chant, quote, all glories, end quote, again and again. Text 36. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his devotees participated in all the festivals known as Ras Yatra, Deepavali, and Uttana Dvadasi. Purport. The Deepavali festival takes place on the dark moon night in the month of Kartik, October-November. The Ras Yatra, or Rasa dancing of Krishna, takes place on the full moon night of the same month. Uttana Dvadasi takes place the day after Ekadasi on the waxing fortnight of the moon in the same month. All the devotees of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu participated in all these festivals. Text 37. One day, the two brothers, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Nityananda Prabhu, consulted one another, sitting together in a solitary place. Text 38. No one could understand what the brothers discussed between themselves, but later all the devotees could guess what the subject matter was. Text 39. Thereafter, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu called for all the devotees and asked them to return to Bengal. In this way, he bade farewell to them. Text 40. Bidding farewell to all the devotees, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu requested them to return to Jagannath Puri every year to see him and then see the cleansing of the Gundicha temple. Text 41. With great respect, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu requested Advaitacharya, quote, "Give Krishna consciousness, devotion to Krishna, even to the lowest of men, chandalas." Purport. This is Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's order to all his devotees. Krishna bhakti, devotion to Krishna, is open to everyone, even low-class men like chandalas. One should follow this order in the disciplic succession stemming from Sri Advaita and Nityananda Prabhu and distribute Krishna consciousness without discrimination throughout the world. There are different kinds of men, beginning with the brahmanas and going down to the lowest platform known as chandala. Whatever one's position, everyone in this age of Kali needs to be enlightened in Krishna consciousness. That is the greatest need of the day. Everyone is acutely feeling the pangs of material existence. Even in the ranks and files of the American Senate, the pinpricks of material existence are felt, so much so that April 30th, 1974 was actually set aside as prayer day. Thus, everyone is feeling the resultant pinpricks of Kali Yuga brought about by human societies indulging in illicit sex, meat eating, gambling, and intoxication. Now is the time for the members of the International Society for Krishna Consciousness to distribute Krishna Bhakti all over the world and thus follow the orders of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. The Lord has ordered everyone to become a guru. Chaitanya Charitamrita 7.128. Amara Gyana Guru Hanatara Edesh. Everyone in every town and village should be enlightened by the instructions of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Krishna consciousness should be distributed to everyone indiscriminately. In this way, the entire world will be peaceful and happy, and everyone will glorify Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu as he desires. The word chandala actually refers to a dog eater who is considered the lowest of men. Even chandalas can be enlightened in Krishna consciousness due to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's benedictions. Krishna bhakti is not the monopoly of a certain caste. Everyone is eligible to receive this great benediction given by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Everyone should be given a chance to receive it and be happy. The word dana, meaning, quote, charity, end quote, is also significant in this verse. Whoever engages in the distribution of Krishna consciousness is a charitable person. Professional men recite Srimad Bhagavatam and discuss Krishna bhakti for an exchange of money. They cannot distribute such exalted transcendental property to everyone and anyone. Only pure devotees who have no motive other than serving Krishna can give such transcendentally valuable benedictions out as charity. Text 42. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu ordered Nityananda Prabhu, quote, go to Bengal and without restriction manifest devotional service to the Lord, Krishna consciousness. Purport. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu thus ordered Nityananda Prabhu to deliver all the Bengalis to devotional service. In the Bhagavad Gita 9.32, it is said, Mam hi partha vipashtya, yepi shu papayonia, shtriya vaishastata shudras, tepi yanti param gatim. Quote, O Sanaprita, those who have to take shelter in me, though they be of lower birth, women, vaishas, merchants, as well as shudras, workers, can approach the supreme destination. End quote. Whoever takes to Krishna consciousness and follows the regulative principles can return home back to Godhead. In his Anubhasya, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur writes, quote, there is a class of so-called devotees called Prakriti Sahajas who think that Nityananda Prabhu is an ordinary human being. They have spread the news that Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu ordered Nityananda Prabhu to return to Bengal from Orissa just to marry and beget children. This is certainly a great offense against Nityananda Prabhu. Such an offense is called Pashandabuddhi, or an atheistic remark. Offenders consider Nityananda Prabhu to be like one of them, an ordinary human being. They do not know of Nityananda Prabhu's identity with the Vishnu Tattva. Thinking Nityananda Prabhu to be an ordinary human being is the business of mental speculators known as Kunapatmavadis. These people accept the material body, which is a bag of three elements, Kunapi Tri Dhatuke, as themselves. They think that Nityananda Prabhu's body was similarly material and that it was meant for sense gratification. Whoever thinks in this way is a candidate for the darkest regions of hell. Those who hanker after money and women, who are self-interested and have the mentality of merchants, can certainly discover many things in their fertile brains and speak against the authorized revealed scriptures. They also engage in some money-making business to cheat innocent people, and they try to support their business programs by making such offensive statements. Actually, Nityananda Prabhu, being the expansion of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, is the most munificent incarnation. No one should consider him an ordinary human being or an entity like the Prajapatis who were ordered by Brahma to increase generation. Nityananda Prabhu should not be considered instrumental for sense gratification. Although professional so-called preachers support this, such statements are not found in any authorized revealed scriptures. Actually, there is no support for these statements made by sahajas or other professional distributors of Krishna bhakti. Text 43. Nityananda Prabhu was given assistants like Ramdas, Gadadhar Das, and several others. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, quote, I give them to you to assist you. Text 44. I shall also go to see you at intervals. Keeping myself invisible, I shall watch you dance. Text 45. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu then embraced Srivas Pandit and, with his arm about his neck, began to speak to him in sweet words. Text 46. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu requested Srivas Thakur, quote, perform congregational chanting daily, and be assured that I shall also dance in your presence. You will be able to see this dancing, but not others. Text 47. Take this prasad of Lord Jagannath and this cloth and deliver them to my mother, Shachi Devi. After offering her obeisances, please request her to excuse my offenses. Text 48. Quote, I have given up the service of my mother and have accepted the sannyas order. Actually, I should have not have done this, but by so doing, I have destroyed my religious principles. Text 49. Quote, I am subordinate to the love of my mother, and it is my duty to serve her in return. Instead of doing so, I have accepted this renounced order. Certainly, this is the act of a madman. Text 50. Quote, a mother is not offended by her mad son, and knowing this, my mother is not offended by me. Text 51. Quote, I had no business in accepting this renounced order and sacrificing the love, my love for my mother, which is my real property. Actually, I was in a crazed state of mind when I accepted sannyas. Text 52. Quote, I am staying here at Jagannath Puri Nilachala to comply with her orders. However, at intervals, I shall go see her lotus feet. Text 53. Indeed, I shall go there daily to see her lotus feet. She is able to feel my presence, although she does not believe it to be true. Text 54 and 55. Quote, one day, my mother Sachi offered food to Shalagram Vishnu. She offered rice cooked from shali patties, various kinds of vegetables, spinach, curry made from banana flowers, fried patola with nimbat leaves, pieces of ginger with lemon, and also yogurt, milk, sugar candy, and many other foods. Text 56. Taking the food upon her lap, mother was crying to think that all the food was very dear to her Nimai. Text 57. My mother was thinking, quote, Nimai is not here. Who will accept all this food? End quote. As she meditated upon me in this way, her eyes filled with tears. Text 58. While she was thus thinking and crying, I immediately went there with great haste and ate everything. Seeing the dish empty, she wiped her tears away. Text 59. She then began to wonder who had eaten all that food. Quote, why is the plate empty? End quote, she wondered, doubting that Balagopal had eaten it all. Text 60. She began to wonder whether there was actually anything on the plate in the first place. Then again, she thought that some animal might have come and eaten everything. Text 61. She thought, quote, perhaps by mistake I did not put any food on the plate, end quote. So thinking, she went into the kitchen and saw the pots. Text 62. When she saw that all the pots were still filled with rice and vegetables, there was some doubt in her mind, and she was astonished. Text 63. Quote, thus wondering, she called Ishana, the servant, who had the place cleaned again. She then offered another plate to Gopal. Text 64. Now, whenever she prepares some good cooked food and wants to feed it to me, she cries in great anxiety. Text 65. Being obliged by her love, I am brought there to eat. Mother knows all these things internally and feels happiness, but externally she does not accept them. Text 66. Such an incident took place on the last Vijayadasami day. You can ask her about this incident and make her believe that I actually go there. Text 67. While describing all this, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was a little overwhelmed, but just to finish bidding farewell to the devotees, he remained patient. Text 68. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu next spoke some relishable words to Raghava Pandit. He said, quote, I am obliged and due to your pure love for me. End quote. Text 69. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu then informed everyone, quote, just hear about the pure devotional service rendered to Krishna by Raghava Pandit. Indeed, Raghava Pandit's service is supremely pure and highly accomplished. Text 70. Apart from other commodities, just hear about his coconut offering. A coconut is sold at the rate of 5 gandas each. Text 71. Quote, although he already has hundreds of trees and millions of fruits, he still is very eager to hear about the place where sweet coconut is available. Text 72. Quote, he collects coconut with great endeavor from a place 20 miles away, and he gives 4 panas for each of them. Tech 73. Every day, 5 to 7 coconuts are clipped and put into water to keep cool. Tech 74. At the time of offering boga, the coconuts are again clipped and cleansed. After holes are made in them, they are offered to Lord Krishna. Tech 75. Lord Krishna used to drink the juice from these coconuts, and sometimes the coconuts were left drained of juice. At other times, the coconuts were filled with juice. Text 76. When Raghava Pandit heard that the juice had been drunk from the coconuts, he was very pleased. He would then break the coconut, take out the pulp, and put it on another plate. Text 77. Quote, after offering the pulp, he would meditate outside the temple door. In the meantime, Lord Krishna, having eaten the pulp, would leave the plate empty. Text 78. Quote, sometimes after eating the pulp, Krishna would fill the plate again with new pulp. In this way, Raghava Pandit's faith increased, and he floats in an ocean of love. Text 79. One day it so happened that about 10 coconuts were properly clipped and brought by a servant to offer to the deity. Text 80. Quote, when the coconuts were brought, there was little time to offer them because it was already late. The servant, holding the container of coconuts, remained standing at the door. Text 81. Raghava Pandit then saw that the servant touched the ceiling above the door and then touched the coconuts with the same hand. Text 82. Raghava Pandit then said, quote, people are always coming and going through that door. The dust from their feet blows up and touches the ceiling. Text 83. Quote, after touching the ceiling above the door, you have touched the coconuts. Now they are no longer fit to be offered to Krishna because they are contaminated. Purport. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur states that Raghava Pandit was not simply a crazy fellow suffering from a cleansing phobia. He did not belong to the mundane world. In lower consciousness, something accepted to be spiritual, accepting something to be spiritual when it is actually material, is called Bhauma Jiyadi. Raghava Pandit was an eternal servant of Krishna, and everything he saw was related to the service of the Lord. He was always absorbed in the transcendental thought of how he could always serve Krishna with everything. Sometimes neophytes, devotees on the lower platform, try to imitate Raghava Pandit on the platform of material purity and impurity. Such imitation will not help anyone. As explained in Chaitanya Charitamrita Antilila 4.174, Badr Badr Vasu Jana Nihika Prakrite. On the transcendental platform, there is no higher or lower, pure or impure. On the material platform, distinction is made between good and bad. But on the spiritual platform, everything is of the same quality. Dvaite Badr Badr Jana Sabhe Mano Dharma A Baila A Manda A Sabha Brahma. Quote, in the material world, conceptions of good and bad are all mental speculations. Quote, therefore saying, quote, this is good and this is bad is all a mistake. End quote. Chaitanya Charitamrita Antilila 4.176. Text 84. Such was the service of Raghava Pandit. He did not accept the coconuts, but threw them over the wall. His service is purely based on unalloyed love, and it conquers the whole world. Text 85. Quote, thereafter, Raghava Pandit had other coconuts gathered, cleansed, and clipped, and with great attention he offered them to the deity to eat. Text 86. In this way, he collected excellent bananas, mangoes, oranges, jackfruits, and whatever first-class fruits from distant villages he had heard about. Text 87. All these fruits were collected from distant places and were brought at a high price. After trimming them with great care and purity, Raghava Pandit offered them to the deity. Text 88. Quote, thus, with great care and attention, Raghava Pandit would prepare spinach, other vegetables, radishes, fruits, chipped rice, powdered rice, and sweetmeats. Text 89. He prepared cakes, sweet rice, concentrated milk, and everything else with great attention, and the cooking conditions were purified so that the food was first class and tasteful. Text 90. Raghava Pandit would also offer all kinds of pickles, such as Kashamdi. He offered various scents, garments, ornaments, and the best of everything. Text 91. Thus, Raghava Pandit would serve the Lord in an incomparable way. Everyone was very satisfied just to see him. End quote. Text 92. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu then mercifully embraced Raghava Pandit. The Lord also offered all the other devotees a reception with similar respect. Text 93. The Lord also respectfully told Shivananda Sen, quote, take care of Vasudev Dutt very nicely. Text 94. Vasudev Dutt is very liberal. Every day, whatever income he receives, he spends. He does not keep any balance. Text 95. Being a householder, Vasudev Dutt needs to save some money. Because he is not doing so, it is very difficult for him to maintain his family. Text 96. Please take care of Vasudev Dutt's family affairs. Become his manager and make the proper adjustments. Purport. Both Vasudev Dutt and Sivananda Sen were living in the same neighborhood, which is presently called Kumarhatta or Halishahara. Text 97, quote, come every year and bring all my devotees with you to the Gundicha festival. I also request you to maintain all of them. End quote. Text 98. The Lord then, with great respect, extended an invitation to all the inhabitants of Kunilagram, asking them to come every year and bring silken rope to carry Lord Jagannath during the Rath Yatra festival. Text 99. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu then said, quote, Gunaraj Khan of Kunilagram compiled a book named Sri Krishna Vijay, in which there is a sentence revealing the author's ecstatic love of Krishna. End quote. Purport. Sri Krishna Vijay is a book of poems considered to be the first poetry book written in Bengal. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur states that this book was compiled in the Bengali Shakabda year 1395. After 7 years, it was completed in 1402 Shakabda. This book was written in plain language, and even half-educated Bengalis and women could read it very clearly. Even ordinary men with little knowledge of the alphabet could read this book and understand it. Its language is not very ornamental, and sometimes the poetry is not very sweet to hear, although according to the sonnet style, each line should contain 14 syllables. Sometimes there are 16, 12, and 13 syllables in his verse. Many words used in those days could be understood only by local inhabitants, yet this book is still so popular that no bookstore is complete without it. It is very valuable for those who are interested in advancing in Krishna consciousness. Sri Gunaraj Khan was one of the topmost Vaishnavas, and he has translated the 10th and 11th cantos of Srimad Bhagavatam for the understanding of the common man. The book Sri Krishna Vijay was highly praised by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and it is very valuable for all Vaishnavas. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur gives a genealogical table and family history of Gunaraj Khan. When a Bengali emperor named Adi Shura first came from Kanyabukubja or Kanauja, he brought with him 5 brahmanas and 5 kayasthas. Since the king is supposed to be accompanied by his associates, the brahmanas accompanied the king to help him in higher spiritual matters. The kayasthas were to render other services. In the northern Indian high country, the kayasthas are accepted as shudras, but in Bengal, the kayasthas are considered among the higher castes. It is a fact that the kayasthas come to Bengal from northern India, specifically from Kanyakubja or Kanauja. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur says that the kayasthas who came from Kanyakubja were high-class men. Of them, Dasarath Vasu was a great personality, and the 13th generation of his family included Gunaraj Khan. His real name was Maladhar Vasu, but the title Khan was given to him by the Emperor of Bengal. Thus, he became known as Gunaraj Khan. Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur gives the following genealogical table of Gunaraj Khan. 1. Dasarath Vasu. 2. Kushala. 3. Shubhar Shankar. 4. Hamsa. 5. Sati Ram Baganda. Muktiram, Mainagara, and Alankara Bangaja, 6. Damodar, 7. Anantaram, 8. Guninayaka and Vinanayaka. The 12th generation included Bhagirath, and the 13th, Maladhar Vasu, or Gunaraj Khan. Sri Gunaraj Khan had 14 sons, of whom the second son, Lakshmana Vasu, received the title Satyaraj Khan. His son was Sri Ramananda Vasu, and therefore Ramananda Vasu belonged to the 15th generation. Gunaraj Khan was a very well-known and wealthy man. His palace, fort, and temples are still existing, and from these we can deduce that the opulence of Gunaraj Khan was certainly very great. Sri Gunaraj Khan never cared for the artificial aristocracy introduced by Balal Sain. Text 100. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, quote, Krishna, the son of Nanda Maharaj, is my life and soul. End quote. By this statement, I am sold into the hands of the descendants of Gunaraj Khan. Purport. The full verse referred to is here. Eka bhave vande hari yoda kadihata nandanandana krishna mora prananat. Quote, with folded hands I offer my prayers unto Krishna, the son of Nanda Maharaj, who is my life and soul. End quote. Text 101. To say nothing of you, even a dog living in your village is very dear to me. What then to speak of others? End quote. Text 102. After this, Ramananda Vasu and Satyaraj Khan both submitted questions at the lotus feet of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Text 103. Satyaraj Khan said, quote, my dear Lord, being a householder and a materialistic man, I do not know the process of advancing in spiritual life. I therefore submit myself to your lotus feet and request you to give me orders. End quote. Text 104. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu replied, without cessation, continue chanting the holy name of Lord Krishna. Whenever possible, serve him and his devotees, the Vaishnavas. End quote. Text 105. Upon hearing this, Satyaraj said, quote, how can I recognize a Vaishnava? Please let me know what a Vaishnava is. What are his common symptoms? End quote. Text 106. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu replied, quote, whoever chants the holy name of Krishna just once is worshipable and is the topmost human being. Purport. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur says that simply by chanting the holy name of Krishna once, a person becomes perfect. Such a person is understood to be a Vaishnava. With such faith and belief, one may begin a life of Krishna consciousness, but an ordinary man cannot chant the holy name of Krishna with such faith. This is confirmed by Srila Rupa Goswami in his Upadeshamrita, Krishneti yasya giri tam manasandrityeta. One should accept the holy name of Krishna to be identical with the Supreme Personality of Godhead, transcendence himself. The holy name of Krishna is also identical with Krishna and is also Chintamani. The name Krishna and the personification of sound, perfectly transcendental and eternally liberated from material contamination. One should understand that the name Krishna and Krishna are identical. Having such faith, one may continue to chant the holy name. When one is situated on the neophyte platform, one cannot understand the devotional ingredients of pure, unalloyed devotee. However, when the novice engages in devotional service, especially in deity worship, and follows the order of a bona fide spiritual master, he becomes a pure devotee. Anyone can take advantage of hearing about Krishna consciousness from a pure devotee and thus gradually become purified. A devotee who believes that the holy name of the Lord is identical with the Lord is a pure devotee, even though he may be in the neophyte stage. By his association, others may also become Vaishnavas. One is known as a materialistic devotee if he simply worships the deity of Hari with faith but does not show proper respect to the devotees and to others. This is confirmed in Srimad Bhagavatam 11.2.47. Archaram eva hariye yapujam sradate hate. Natad Bhakteshu Chanyeshu Sabhakta Prakriti Smrita. Quote, anyone who engages with faith in the worship of the deity of Hari, but does not show proper respect to the devotees and to others, is known as a materialistic devotee, end quote. However, by associating with a neophyte devotee who believes that the holy name of the Lord is identical with the Lord, one can become a devotee also. When Lord Chaitanya was teaching Sanatana Goswami, he said, Shravan jana hai bhakti adhikar uttama madhyama kanishta shraddha anusari yahara komala shraddha se kanishta janma kramne kramne tenho bhakta hai vet uttama rati prema taratyame bhakti taratama. Quote, a person who has attained firm faith is a real candidate for advancing in Krishna consciousness. According to the faith, there are first class, second class, and neophyte devotees. One who has preliminary faith is called Kanishta, or a neophyte. The neophyte, however, can become an advanced devotee if he strictly follows the regulative principles set down by the spiritual master. The pure devotee whose faith advances becomes a Madhyamadhikari or Uttamadhikari, end quote. Chaitanya Charitamrita 22:64 and 69 through 70. Thus, it is concluded that even a neophyte devotee is superior to the karmis and gyanis because he has full faith in the chanting of the holy name of the Lord. A karmi or a gyani, regardless of his greatness, has no faith in Lord Vishnu, his holy name, or his devotional service. One may be advanced religiously, but if he is not trained in devotional service, he has very little credit on the transcendental platform. Even a neophyte devotee engaged in deity worship in accordance with the regulations set forth by the spiritual master is in a position superior to that of the fruitive worker and speculative philosopher. Text 107. Quote, simply by chanting the holy name of Krishna, one is relieved from all the reactions of sinful life. One can complete the nine processes of devotional service simply by chanting the holy name. Purport. The nine types of devotional service are mentioned in Srimad Bhagavatam 7.5.23. Shravanam Kirtanam Vishnu Smaranam Padasevanam Archanam Vandanam Dasyam Shakyam Apmanivedanam Iti Pumsha Pita Vishnu Bhaktis Chain Nava Lakshana Kriyate Bhagavati Ada Tanmanye Ditam Uttamam. Quote, these are the activities of hearing, chanting, remembering, serving, worshipping, praying, obeying, maintaining friendship, and surrendering everything. As far as chanting the holy name of Krishna is concerned, one can be freed from all sinful reactions by chanting the holy name without committing offenses. If one chants offenselessly, he may be saved from all sinful reactions. It is very important in devotional service to chant the holy name of the Lord without committing offenses. The nine devotional processes, such as Shravanam and Kirtana, can all be attained at once if one simply chants the holy name of the Lord offenselessly. In this regard, Srila Jiva Goswami states in his book Bhakti Sandarbha 173, Yadyapi Anya Bhakti Kalo Kartavya Tada Kirtanakya Bhakti Samyoganaiva. Out of the nine processes of devotional service, kirtan is very important. Srila Jiva Goswami therefore instructs that the other processes, such as Archana, Vandana, Dasya, and Shakya, should be executed, but they must be preceded and followed by kirtan, the chanting of the holy name. We have therefore introduced this system in all of our centers. Archana, Arti, Bhoga offering, deity dressing, and decoration are all preceded and followed by the chanting of the holy name of the Lord. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Text 108. Quote, one does not have to undergo invitation or initiation to execute the activities required before initiation. One simply has to vibrate the holy name with his lips. Thus, even a man in the lowest class, Chandala, can be delivered. Purport. Srila Jiva Goswami explains Diksha in his Bhakti Sandarbha 283. Divyan Gyanam Yato Dadyat Kuryat Papasya Shankshayam Tasmat Dikshati Saprokta Dishikais Tattva Krovida. Quote, Diksha is the process by which one can awaken his transcendental knowledge and vanquish all reactions caused by sinful activity. A person expert in the study of the revealed scriptures knows this process as Diksha, end quote. The regulative principles of Diksha are explained in the Hari Bhakti Vilas, Vilas 1, 2, 3, and 4, and in Bhakti Sandarbha 283. As stated, Dvijanam Anupatenanam Swakar Madhya Yan Nadishu Yatandikaro Nashtihita Yachopana Yanad Anu Tatadra Dikshitanam Tu Mantra Deva Chan Nadishu Nadikaro Sti Adha Kuryad Atmanam Shiva Sumstutam. Quote, even though born in a Brahmana family, one cannot engage in Vedic rituals without being initiated and having a sacred thread. Although born in a Brahmana family, one becomes a Brahmana after initiation and the sacred thread ceremony. Unless one is initiated as a Brahmana, he cannot worship the holy name properly. End quote. According to the Vaishnava regulative principles, one must be initiated as a Brahmana. The Hari Bhakti Vilas 2.6 quotes the following injunction from the Vishnu Yamala.
Adikshiktasya vamo nru kritam sarvam nirakthakam pashu yonim avapnoti diksha virahito jana.
Quote, unless one is initiated by a bona fide spiritual master, all his devotional activities are useless. A person who is not properly initiated can descend again into the animal species. End quote. Hari Bhakti Vilas 2.10 further quotes, Ato gurum pranamyaivam sarvasvam vedecha griniyad vaishnavam mantram diksha purvam vidanataha. Quote, it is the duty of every human being to surrender to a bona fide spiritual master, giving him everything, body, mind, and intelligence. One must take a Vaishnava initiation from him. End quote. The Bhakti Sandarbha 298 gives the following quotation from the Tattva Sagara. Yata kanchantanam kanchanatam yati yasyam rasa vidanata tata dikshan vidanena dvijatvam jayate nrinam. Quote, by chemical manipulation, bell metal is turned into gold when touched by mercury. Similarly, when a person is properly initiated, he can acquire the qualities of a brahmana. End quote. The Hari Bhakti Vilas 17.11.12, in discussing the Purush Chaya process, quotes the following verses from the Agastya Samhita. Puja Trai Ka Laki Nityam Japas Tarpanam Evacha Homo bo brahmana bhuktischa purascharanam uchyate guru labhasya mantrasya prasadena yatavidi panchan go pashana siddhyai purascharai tad vidhiyate. Quote, in the morning, afternoon, and evening, one should worship the deity, chant the Hare Krishna mantra, offer oblations, perform a fire sacrifice, and feed the brahmanas. These five activities constitute purushcharya. To attain full success, when taking initiation from the spiritual master, one should first perform these purushcharya processes. End quote. The word pura means, quote, before, and charya means, quote, activities, end quote. Due to the necessity of these activities, we do not immediately initiate disciples in the International Society for Krishna Consciousness. For 6 months, a candidate for initiation must first attend arti and classes from the shastras, practice the regulative principles, and associate with other devotees. When one is actually advanced in the purushcharya vidhi, he is recommended by the local temple president for initiation. It is not that anyone can suddenly be initiated without meeting the requirements. When one is further advanced by chanting the Hare Krishna mantra 16 rounds daily,
Following the regular principles and attending classes, he receives the sacred thread, brahminical recognition, after the second 6 months. In the Hari Bhakti Vilas 17, 4, 5, and 7, it is stated, Vinayena na siddhayishyan mantra varsha statayapi kritena yena labhate sadhako vanchitam phalam purasharana sampano mantro hi faladayaka ata purakshkriyam kuryat mantra vit siddhi kankashaya purakshkriya hi mantranam prahadam viram uchate viryahino yata dehi sarva karmashu nakshama purakshcharana hino hi tata mantra pratitita. Quote, without performing the purushcharya activities, one cannot become perfect even by chanting this mantra for hundreds of years. However, one who has undergone the purushcharya vidhi process can attain success very easily. If one wishes to perfect his initiation, he must first undergo the purushcharya activities. The purushcharya process is the life force by which one is successful in chanting the mantra. Without the life force, one cannot do anything. Similarly, without the life force of purushcharya vidhi, no mantra can be perfected. End quote. In his Bhakti Sandarbha 283, Srila Jiva Goswami states, Yadyapi Sri Bhagavat Mate Pancharatra Yat Acharna Magasya Aishya Kavtvam Nashti Tad Vinapi Sharanat Pati Adinam Atarenapi Purushartav Siddhir Abhinhitatvat Tatapi Sri Naradadi Vartmanu Sharabdi Sri Bhagavata Saha Sambandha Vishesham Diksha Vidhanena Sri Guru Charana Sampaditam Chikir Sad Bi Kritayam Dikshiyam Archanam Asrayam Kriyataiva. Of similar importance is Diksha, which is explained as follows in Bhakti Sandarbha 284. Yadyapi Swarupato Nasti Tatapi Praya Svabhavato Dadati Sambandena Kardaya Silanam Vikshipta Chitanam Gananam Tat Tat Sankochi Karanam or Karanaya Srimad Rishi Pratidibir Atra charna marge kachit 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 kachin maryada stapita sti. Similarly, in Ramachandra Chandrika, it is stated, Vinaiva diksham vipenda purushcharyam vinaivi hi Vinaiva nasya videna japa mantrena shidhida. In other words, the chanting of the Hare Krishna mantra is so powerful that it does not depend on an official initiation, but one who is initiated and engages in Pancharatra Vidhi, deity worship, his Krishna consciousness will awaken very soon and his identification with the material world will be vanquished. The more one is freed from material identification, the more one can realize that the spirit soul is qualitatively as good as the Supreme Soul. At such a time, when one is situated on the absolute platform, he can understand that the holy name of the Lord and the Lord himself are identical. At that stage of realization, the holy name of the Lord, the Hare Krishna mantra, cannot be identified with any material sound. If one accepts the Hare Krishna Maha mantra as a material vibration, he falls down. One should worship and chant the holy name of the Lord by accepting it as the Lord himself. Therefore, one should be initiated properly according to the revealed scriptures under the direction of the bona fide spiritual master. Although chanting the holy name is good for both the conditioned and liberated soul, it is especially beneficial to the conditioned soul because by chanting, one is liberated. When a person who chants the holy name is liberated, he attains the ultimate perfection of by returning home back to Godhead. In the words of Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, Adi Lila 773, Krishna mantra haiti habe samsara mochan, Krishna nama haiti pabi Krishna racharan. Quote, Simply by chanting the holy name of Krishna, one can obtain freedom from material existence. Indeed, simply by chanting the Hare Krishna mantra, one will be able to see the lotus feet of the Lord. End quote. The offenseless chanting of the holy name does not depend on the initiation process. Although initiation may depend on Purushcharya or Purushcharana, the actual chanting of the holy name does not depend on Purushcharya Vidhi or the regulative principles. If one chants the holy name once without committing an offense, he attains all success. During the chanting of the holy name, the tongue must work. Simply by chanting the holy name, one is immediately delivered. The tongue is seva mukhe jiva. It is controlled by service. One whose tongue is engaged in tasting material things and also talking about them cannot use the tongue for absolute realization. Atasi Krishna Namadi Nabhaved Griyam Indriyai Seva Mukhe Jivado Swayameva Svaratyada. According to Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhya Lila 17.134, Ataiva Krishnara Nam Dehat Vilas Prakritendiya Griya Nane Nahe Haya Sva Prakash. Quote, with these material senses, one cannot understand the transcendental holy name of the Lord or his form, activities, and pastimes. However, when one actually engages in devotional service, utilizing the tongue, the Lord is revealed. End quote. Text 109. Quote, by chanting the holy name of the Lord, one dissolves his entanglement in material activities. After this, one becomes very attracted to Krishna, and thus dormant love for Krishna is awakened. Text 110. Quote, the holy name of Lord Krishna is an attractive feature for many saintly liberal people. It is the annihilator of all sinful reactions and is so powerful that save for the dumb who cannot chant it, it is readily available to everyone, including the lowest type of men, the chandala. The holy name of Krishna is the controller of the opulence of liberation, and it is identical with Krishna. Simply by touching the holy name with one's tongue, immediate effects are produced. Chanting the holy name does not depend on initiation, pious activities, or the Purushcharya regulative principles generally observed before initiation. The holy name does not wait for all these activities. It is self-sufficient. End quote. Purport. This verse is found in the Padyavali 29 by Srila Rupa Goswami, text 111. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu then finally advised, quote, one who is chanting the Hare Krishna mantra is understood to be a Vaishnava, and therefore you should offer all respects to him, end quote. Purport. In his Upadeshamrita, Srila Rupa Goswami states, Krishneti yasya giritam manasadriyeta dikshati chit. An advanced devotee should respect a person who has been initiated by a bona fide spiritual master and who is situated on the transcendental platform, chanting the holy name with faith and obeisances and following the instructions of the spiritual master. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur comments that serving Vaishnavas is most important for householders. Whether a Vaishnava is properly initiated or not is not a subject for consideration. One may be initiated and yet contaminated by the Mayavad philosophy, but a person who chants the holy name of the Lord offenselessly will not be so contaminated. A properly initiated Vaishnava may be imperfect, but one who chants the holy name of the Lord offenselessly is all perfect. Although he may apparently be a neophyte, he still has to be considered a pure, unalloyed Vaishnava. It is the duty of the householder to offer respects to such an unalloyed Vaishnava. This is Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's instruction. Text 112. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu then turned his attention to three persons, Mukunda Das, Raghunanda, and Sri Narhari, inhabitants of the place called Kanda. Text 113. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the son of Mother Sachi, next asked Mukunda Das, quote, you are the father and your son is Raghunanda, is that so? Text 114, quote, or is Sri Raghunanda your father, whereas you are his son? Please let me know the facts so that my doubts will go away, end quote. Text 115. Mukunda replied, Raghunanda is my father and I am his son. This is my decision. Text 116. All of us have attained devotion to Krishna due to Raghunanda. Therefore, in my mind, he is my father. Text 117. Hearing Mukunda Das give this proper decision, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu confirmed it, saying, quote, yes, this is correct. One who awakens devotion to Krishna is certainly a spiritual master. Text 118. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu became very happy just to speak of the glories of his devotees. Indeed, when he spoke of their glories, it was as if he had five faces. Text 119. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu then informed all his devotees, quote, please hear about Mukunda's love of Godhead, for it is very deep and it is a very deep and pure love that and can only be compared with purified gold. Text 120. Mukunda Das externally appears to be a royal physician engaged in government service, but internally he has a deep love for Krishna. Who can understand his love? Purport. Unless Sri Krishna Chaitanya Mahaprabhu discloses the fact, no one can understand who is actually a great devotee of the Lord engaged in his service. It is therefore said in Chaitanya Charitamrita Madhya 23-39, Tanra Vakya Kriya Mudra Vijneha Nabujai. Even the most perfect and learned scholar cannot understand a Vaishnava's activities. A Vaishnav may be engaged in government service or in a professional business so that externally one cannot understand his position. Internally, however, he may be a Nityasiddha Vaishnava, that is, an eternally liberated Vaishnava. Externally, Mukunda Das was a royal physician, but internally he was the most liberated Paramahansa devotee. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu knew this very well, but ordinary men could not understand it, for the activities and plans of a Vaishnava cannot be understood by ordinary men. However, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his representative understand everything about a devotee. Even though the devotee may externally pretend to be an ordinary householder and professional businessman. Text 121. Quote, one day, Mukunda Das, the royal physician, was seated with the Mohammedan king on a high platform and was telling the king about medical treatment. Text 122. While the king and Mukunda Das were conversing, a servant brought a fan made of peacock feathers to shade the head of the king from the sun. Consequently, he held the fan above the king's head. Text 123. Just by seeing the peacock-feathered fan, Mukunda Das became absorbed in ecstatic love of God and fell from the high platform onto the ground. Text 124. The king, fearing that the royal physician was killed, personally descended and brought him to his consciousness. Text 125. Quote, when the king asked Mukunda, quote, what is paining you? End quote. Mukunda replied, quote, I am not very much pained. End quote. Text 126. The king then inquired, Mukunda, why did you fall down? Mukunda replied, my dear king, I have disease that is like epilepsy. Text 127. Quote, being extraordinarily intelligent, the king could understand the whole affair. In his estimation, Mukunda was a most uncommon, exalted, liberated personality. Text 128, 129. Raghunanda is constantly engaged in serving the temple of Lord Krishna. Beside the entrance of the temple is a lake, and on its bank is a kadamba tree, which daily delivers two flowers to be used in Krishna's service. Text 130. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu then spoke to Mukunda with sweet words. Quote, your duty is to earn both material and spiritual wealth. Text 131. Quote, furthermore, it is the duty of Raghunanda to always engage in Lord Krishna's service. He has no other intention but the service of Lord Krishna. Text 132. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu then ordered Narahari, quote, I wish you to remain here with my devotees. In this way, the three of you should always execute these three duties for the service of the Lord. End quote. Purport. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu set forth three duties for three different people. Mukunda was to earn money and follow the regular religious principles, whereas Narahari was to remain with the Lord's devotees, and Raghunanda was to engage in the Lord's service in the temple. Thus, one person worships in the temple, another earns money honestly by executing his professional duty, and yet another preaches Krishna consciousness with the devotees. Apparently, these three types of service appear separate, but actually they are not. When Krishna or Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is the center, everyone can engage in different activities for the service of the Lord. This is the verdict of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Text 133. Out of his causeless mercy, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gave the following directions to the brothers Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya and Vidya Vishapati.
Text 134. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, quote, "In this age of Kali, Krishna is manifest in two forms, wood and water. Thus he helps conditioned souls to become liberated by seeing the wood and bathing in the water." Text 135. Lord Jagannath is the Supreme Lord himself in the form of wood, and the river Ganges is the Supreme Lord himself in the form of water. Purport. The Vedas enjoin Sarvam Kalavidam Brahma. Everything is the energy of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the Supreme Brahman or Param Brahman. Parashya Brahmana Shakti Statetam Ikalam Jagat. Everything is a manifestation of the energy of the Supreme Brahman. Since the energy and energetic are identical, actually everything is Krishna, Param Brahman. Bhagavad Gita 9.4 confirms this. Mayam tatam idam sarvam jagat pavyakti murtina matstani sarvabhutani nachaham tveshavastita. Quote, "By me and my unmanifested form, this entire universe is pervaded. All beings are in me, but I am not in them." End quote. Krishna is spread throughout the whole universe in his impersonal form. Since everything is a manifestation of the Lord's energy, the Lord can manifest himself through any energy. In this age, the Lord is manifest through wood as Lord Jagannath, and he is manifest through water as the river Ganges. Therefore, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu ordered the two brothers, Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya and Vidya Vishtrapati, to worship Lord Jagannath and the river Ganges. Text 136. Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya, you should engage in the worship of Lord Jagannath Purushottama, and Vishchapati should worship Mother Ganges. End quote. Text 137. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu then embraced Murari Gupta and began to speak about his firm faith in devotional service. This was heard by all the devotees. Text 138. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, quote, "Previously, I induced Murari Gupta again and again to be allured by Lord Krishna. I said to him, quote, 'My dear Gupta, Lord Shri Krishna Virgendra Kumar is the Supreme Sweetness.'" Text 139. Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the origin of all incarnations and the source of everything. He is pure transcendental love itself, and he is the reservoir of all pleasure. Text 140. Krishna is the reservoir of all transcendental qualities. He is like a mine of gems. He is expert at everything and very intelligent and sober, and he is the summit of all humors. Text 141. His character is very sweet and his pastimes are melodious. He is expert in intelligence and thus he enjoys all his pastimes and mellows. Text 142. I then requested Murari Gupta, quote, "Worship Krishna and take shelter of him, but for his service nothing appeals to the mind." Text 143. In this way he heard from me again and again. By my influence his mind was a little converted. Text 144. Murari Gupta then replied, "I am a servant and your order carrier. I have no independent existence." End quote. Text 145. After this, Murari Gupta went home and spent the whole night thinking how he would be able to give up the association of Raghunath, Lord Ramchandra. Thus, he was overwhelmed. Text 146. Murari Gupta then began to pray at the lotus feet of Lord Ramchandra. He prayed that death would come that night because it was not possible for him to give up the service of the lotus feet of Raghunath. Text 147. Thus, Murari Gupta cried the entire night. There was no rest for his mind. Therefore, he could not sleep, but stayed awake the entire night. Text 148. In the morning, Murari Gupta came to see me, catching hold of my feet and crying. He submitted an appeal. Text 149. Murari Gupta said, quote, "I have sold my head to the lotus feet of Raghunath. I cannot withdraw my head, for that would give me too much pain." Text 150. "It is not possible for me to give up the service of Raghunath's lotus feet. At the same time, if I do not do so, I shall break your order. What can I do?" Text 151. In this way, Murari Gupta appealed to me, saying, quote, "Kindly grant me this mercy because you are all merciful. Let me die before you so that all my doubts will be finished." Text 152. Hearing this, I became very happy. I then raised Murari Gupta and embraced him. Text 153.
I said to him, quote, "All glories to you, Murari Gupta. Your method of worship is very firmly fixed, so much so that even upon my request, your mind did not turn." Text 154, quote, "The servitor must have love and affection for the lotus feet of the Lord exactly like this. Even if the Lord wants separation, a devotee cannot abandon the shelter of his lotus feet." Purport. The word Prabhu, or master, indicates that the Lord is to be continuously served by his devotee. The original Prabhu is the Lord, Sri Krishna. Nonetheless, there are many devotees attached to Lord Ramchandra, and Murari Gupta is a vivid example of such unalloyed devotion. He never agreed to give up Lord Ramchandra's worship, not even upon Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's request. Such is the chastity of devotional service, as stated in the Antya-lila Chaitanya Charitamrita 446 and 47. Sa bhakta danye yena chada prabhura charana se prabhu danye nacha chaiti nija jana dirdaive sevaka yadi yaya anyeshtane se takur danye tare chale dare ane. Quote, "In a firm relationship with the Lord, the devotee does not give up the Lord's service under any circumstances. As far as the Lord himself is concerned, if the devotee chooses to leave, the Lord brings him back again, dragging him by the hair." Text 155. Quote, "Just to test your firm faith in your Lord, I requested you again and again to change your worship to Lord Ramchandra to Krishna." End quote. Text 156. "In this way, I congratulated Murari Gupta, saying, quote, indeed, you are the incarnation of Hanuman. Consequently, you are the eternal servant of Lord Ramchandra. Why should you give up the worship of Lord Ramchandra and his lotus feet?" End quote. Text 157. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu continued, "I accept this Murari Gupta as my life and soul. When I hear of his humility, it perturbs my very life." Text 158. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu then embraced Vasudev Dat and began to speak of his glories as if he had 1,000 mouths. Text 158. When Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu glorified him, Vasudev Dat immediately became very embarrassed and shy. He then submitted himself, touching the Lord's lotus feet. Text 160. Vasudev Dat told Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, quote, "My dear Lord, you incarnate just to deliver all conditioned souls. I have now one petition which I wish you would accept." Text 161. Quote, "My Lord, you are certainly capable of doing whatever you like, and you are indeed merciful. If you do so desire, you can very easily do whatever you want." Text 162. Quote, "My Lord, my heart breaks to see the sufferings of all conditioned souls. Therefore, I request you to transfer the karma of their sinful lives upon my head." Text 163. Quote, "My dear Lord, let me suffer perpetually in a hellish condition, accepting all the sinful reactions of all living entities. Please finish their diseased material life." Purport. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur gives the following commentary on this verse. In the Western countries, Christians believe that Lord Jesus Christ, their spiritual master, appeared in order to eradicate all the sins of his disciples. To this end, Lord Jesus Christ appeared and disappeared. Here, however, we find Sri Vasudev Dat Thakur and Sri Haridas Thakur to be many millions of times more advanced, even when compared to Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ relieved only his followers from all sinful reactions, but Vasudev Dat is here prepared to accept the sins of everyone in the universe. A Vaishnava is so liberal that he is prepared to risk everything to rescue conditioned souls from material existence. Srila Vasudev Dat Thakur is universal love itself, for he was willing to sacrifice everything and fully engage in the service of the Supreme. Srila Vasudev Dat knew very well that Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was the original personality of Godhead. He was transcendence itself, above the material conception of illusion and Maya. Lord Jesus Christ certainly finished the sinful reactions of his followers by his mercy, but that does not mean that he completely delivered them from the pangs of material existence. A person may be relieved from sins once, but it is a practice among Christians to confess sins and yet commit them again. By getting freed from sins and engaging in them again, One cannot attain freedom from the pangs of material existence. A diseased person may go to a physician for relief, but after he leaves the hospital, he may again be infected due to his unclean habits. Thus, material existence continues. Srila Vasudeva Datta wanted to completely relieve the conditioned souls from material existence so that they would no longer have an opportunity to commit sinful acts. This is the difference between Srila Vasudeva Datta and Lord Jesus Christ. It is a great offense to receive pardon for sins and then commit the same sins again. Such an offense is more dangerous than the sinful activity itself. Vasudeva Datta was so liberal that he requested Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to transfer all offensive activity upon him so that the conditioned souls might be purified. This prayer was certainly without duplicity. Vasudeva Datta's example is unique not only within this world but within the universe. It is beyond the conception of furtive actors or the mental speculation of mundane philosophers. Due to being illusioned by the external energy and due to a poor fund of knowledge, people tend to envy one another. Because of this, they are entangled in fruitive activity, and they try to escape this fruitive activity by mental speculation. Consequently, neither karmis nor gyanis are purified. In the words of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur, they are kukarmis and kujyanis, bad actors and bad speculators. The Mayavadis and Karmis should therefore turn their attention to the magnanimous Vasudeva Datta, who wanted to suffer for others in a hellish condition. No, nor should one consider Vasudeva Datta a mundane philanthropist or welfare worker. He was not interested in merging into the Brahman effulgence, nor was he interested in material honor or reputation. He was far above philanthropists, philosophers, and fruitive actors. He was a most exalted personality who wanted to show mercy upon conditioned souls. This is not an exaggeration of his transcendental qualities. It is perfectly true. Actually, there cannot be any comparison to Vasudeva Datta. He was a Vaishnava, paradukaduki, very much aggrieved to see others suffer. The entire world is purified simply by the appearance of such a great devotee. By his presence, the whole world is glorified, and all conditioned souls due to his transcendental presence are also glorified. Srinarottam Das Thakur confirms Vasudeva Datta is the ideal devotee of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Garangera Sangegani Nitya Siddha Karimani Se Yaya Virjendra Sutapash. One who executes Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mission must be considered to be eternally liberated. He is a transcendental person and does not belong to this material world. Such a devotee engaging in the deliverance of the total population is as magnanimous as Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself. Namo Mamaha Varanyaya Krishna Prema Pradayate Krishnaya Krishna Chaitanya Namne Gaurtished Maha. Such a personality factually represents Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu because his heart is always filled with compassion for conditioned souls. Text 164. When Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu heard Vasudeva Datta's statement, his heart became very soft. Tears flowed from his eyes, and he began to tremble. In a faltering voice, he spoke as follows. Text 165. Accepting Vasudeva Datta as a great devotee, the Lord said, quote, such a statement is not at all astonishing because you are the incarnation of Prahlad Maharaj. It appears that Lord Krishna has bestowed complete mercy upon you. There is no doubt about it. Text 166. Whatever a pure devotee wants from his master, Lord Krishna doubtlessly grants, because he has no duty other than to fulfill the desire of his devotee. Text 167. Quote, if you desire the deliverance of all living entities within the universe, then all of them can be delivered even without your undergoing the tribulations of sinful activity. Text 168. Krishna is not incapable, for he has all potencies. Why would he induce you to suffer the sinful reactions of other living entities? Text 169. Quote, whosoever welfare you desire immediately becomes a Vaishnava, and Krishna delivers all Vaishnavas from the reactions of their past sinful activities. Purport. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu here informed Vasudeva Datta that since Krishna is all-powerful, he can immediately deliver all conditioned souls from material existence.
In essence, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, quote, "You desire the liberation of all kinds of living entities without discrimination. You are very anxious for their good fortune, and I say that simply by your prayer, all living entities within the universe can be liberated. You do not even have to take up the burden of their sinful activities. Thus, there is no need for you to suffer for their sinful lives. Whoever receives your compassion becomes a Vaishnava immediately, and Krishna delivers all Vaishnavas from the reactions of their past sinful activities," end quote. This is also promised in Bhagavad Gita 18:66, Sarva Dharman Pratyaja Mamekam Sharanam Bhajaham Tam Sarva Papebhyo Mokshe Shami Masha Cha. Quote, "Abandon all varieties of religion and just surrender unto me. I shall deliver you from all sinful reaction. Do not fear," end quote. As soon as one fully surrenders to Krishna, he becomes a Vaishnava. In this verse from Bhagavad Gita, Krishna promises to relieve his devotee from all the reactions of sinful life. It is a fact that a fully surrendered Vaishnava is completely out of the range of material infection. That is to say that he does not suffer the results of pious or impious actions. Unless one is free from a sinful life, he cannot become a Vaishnava. In other words, if one is a Vaishnava, his sinful life is certainly ended. According to Padma Purana, aparakba phalam papam kutam bijam phalon mukam kramanaiva pralieta vishnu bhakti ratatmanam. Quote, "There are different stages of dormant reactions to sinful activities to be observed in a sinful life. Sinful reactions may be just waiting to take effect, phalon mukha reactions may still be further dormant, kuta, or the reactions may be in a seed-like state, bija. In all cases, all types of sinful reactions are vanquished one after another if a person engages in the devotional service of Lord Vishnu," end quote. Text 170. Quote, "Let me offer my respectful obeisances unto this original personality of Godhead, Govinda, who regulates the sufferings and enjoyments of fruitive activity for everyone, from the heavenly king Indra down to the smallest insect, Indragopa. That very personality of Godhead destroys the fruitive karma of one engaged in devotional service," end quote. Purport. This is a quotation from Brahma Samhita 554. Text 171. Quote, "Because of your honest desire, all living entities within the universe will be delivered, for Krishna does not have to do anything to deliver all the living entities of the universe." Text 172. Quote, "Just as there are millions of fruits on the Udumbara tree, millions of universes float on the waters of the river Viraja." Purport. Viraja is a river that divides the material world from the spiritual world. On one side of the river Viraja is the effulgence of Brahmaloka and innumerable Vaikuntha planets, and on the other side is this material world. It is to be understood that this side of the river Viraja is filled with material planets floating in the causal ocean. The name Viraja indicates a marginal position between the spiritual and material worlds, but this Viraja river is not under the control of material energy. Consequently, is devoid of the three gunas. Text 173. "The Udumbara tree is filled with millions of fruits, and if one falls down and is destroyed, the tree does not even consider the loss." Text 174. Quote, "In the same way, if one universe is vacated due to the living entities having been liberated, that is a very little thing for Krishna. He does not take it very seriously." Text 175. Quote, "The entire spiritual world constitutes the unlimited opulence of Krishna, and there are innumerable Vaikuntha planets there. The causal ocean is considered the surrounding waters of Vaikuntha Loka." Text 176. "Maya and her unlimited material universes are situated in that causal ocean. Indeed, Maya appears to be floating like a pot filled with mustard seeds." Text 177. "If the millions of mustard seeds floating in that pot, if one seed is lost, the loss is not at all significant. Similarly, if one universe is lost, it is not significant to Lord Krishna." Text 178. "To say nothing of one universal mustard seed, even if all the universes and the material energy, Maya, are destroyed, Krishna does not even consider the loss." Text 179.
If a person possessing millions of wish-fulfilling cows loses one she-goat, he does not consider the loss. Krishna owns all six opulences in full. If the entire material energy is destroyed, what does he lose? End quote. Purport. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, in clarifying verses 171 to 179, states that the meaning of these stanzas is very simple, but that the purport is a little difficult to understand. Generally, conditioned souls forget Krishna when they are enticed by the material external energy. Consequently, they are called Krishna Bahir Mukta, bereft of their relationship with Krishna. When such a living entity comes under the jurisdiction of the material energy, he is sent to one of the innumerable material universes created by the material energy to give a chance to conditioned souls to enjoy their desires in the material world. Being very eager to enjoy the fruits of their activities, conditioned souls become involved in the actions and reactions of material life. Consequently, one has to enjoy and suffer the results of karma. However, if a conditioned soul becomes Krishna conscious, the karma of his pious and impious activities is completely destroyed. Simply by becoming a devotee, one is bereft of all the reactions of karma. Similarly, simply by the desire of a devotee, a conditioned soul can attain liberation and transcend the results of karma. If everyone is liberated in this way, one may conclude that according to the sweet will of the devotee, the material world exists or does not exist. Ultimately, however, it is not the sweet will of the devotee, but the will of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who, if he so desires, can completely annihilate the material creation. There is no loss on his part. The owner of millions of cows does not consider the loss of one she-goat. Similarly, Lord Krishna is the proprietor of both material and spiritual universes. The material world constitutes only one-fourth of his creative energy. If, according to the desires of the devotee, the Lord completely destroys the creation, he is so opulent that he will not mind the loss. Text 180. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu continued, quote, O my Lord, O unconquerable one, O master of all potencies, please exhibit your internal potency to conquer the nescience of all moving and inert living entities. Due to nescience, they accept all kinds of faulty things, thus promoting a fearful situation. O Lord, please show your glories. You can do this very easily, for your internal potency is beyond the external potency, and you are the reservoir of all opulence. You are also the demonstrator of the marginal material potency. You are also always engaged in your pastimes in the spiritual world. You exhibit your reserved internal potency and sometimes exhibit the external potency by glancing over it. Thus you manifest your pastimes. The Vedas confirm your two potencies and accept both types of pastimes due to them. End quote. Purport. This verse is taken from Srimad Bhagavatam 10.87.14. It is from the prayers of the Shrutigana, the personified Vedas who glorify the Lord. The Almighty Personality of Godhead has three potencies, internal, external, and marginal. When the conditioned souls are condemned due to forgetfulness, the external potency creates the material world and puts the living entities under its control. The three modes of material nature keep the living entity in a constant state of fear. Bhayam dvitiya binash vishata. The controlled conditioned soul is always fearful due to being controlled by the external potency. Therefore, the conditioned soul should always pray to the Almighty Lord to conquer the external potency, Maya, so that she will no longer manifest her powers, which bind all living entities, moving and inert. Text 181. In this way, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu described the good qualities of his devotees one after the other. He then embraced them and bade them farewell. Text 182. Due to the impending separation from Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, all the devotees began to cry. The Lord was also morose due to separation from the devotees. Text 183. Gadadhar Pandit remained with Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and he was given a place to live at Yameshwar. Purport. Yameshwar is on the southern side of the Jagannath temple. Gadadhar Pandit resided there, and there was a small garden with a sandy beach known as Vameshwar Tota. Text 184 and 85. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu remained at Jagannath Puri Nilachala with Paramananda Puri, Jagadananda, Swarup Damodar, Damodar Pandit, Govinda, and Kashishwar.
It was Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's daily business to see Lord Jagannath in the morning. Text 186. One day, Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya came before Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu with folded hands and submitted a request. Text 187. Since all the Vaishnavas had returned to Bengal, there was a good chance that the Lord would accept an invitation. Text 188. Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya said, quote, please accept my invitation for lunch for 1 month. The Lord replied, quote, that is not possible because it is against the religious principles of a sannyasi. End quote. Text 189. Sarvabhauma then said, quote, please accept the invitation for 20 days. End quote. But Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu replied, quote, it is not a religious principle of the renounced order. End quote. Text 190. When Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya requested Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to accept lunch for 15 days, the Lord said, I shall accept lunch at your place for 1 day only. End quote. Text 191. Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya then caught hold of the Lord's lotus feet and submissively begged, quote, please accept lunch for at least 10 days. End quote. Text 192. In this way, by and by, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu reduced the duration to 5 days. Thus, for 5 days, he regularly accepted the invitation to lunch. Text 193. After this, Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya said, quote, my lord, there are 10 sannyasis with you. Purport. A sannyasi should not cook food for himself or accept an invitation to eat at a devotee's house continuously for many days. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was very kind and affectionate toward his devotees, yet he would not accept a long invitation at Sarvabhauma's house. Out of affection, he accepted only 5 days in the month. The 10 sannyasis living with the Lord were, quote, 1, Paramananda Puri, 2, Sarvabhauma, 3, Brahmananda Puri, 4, Brahmananda Bharati, 5, Vishnu Puri, 6, Keshava Puri, 7, Krishnananda Puri, 8, Nishinga Tirtha, 9, Shukananda Puri, and 10, Satyananda Bharati. Text 194. Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya then submitted that Paramananda Puri Goswami should accept a 5-day invitation at his place. This was settled before the Lord. Text 195. Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya said, quote, Sarvabhaumadhar is my intimate friend. He will come sometimes with you and sometimes alone. Text 196. Quote, the other 8 sannyasis will accept invitations for 2 days each. In this way, there will be engagements for each and every day during the entire month. Purport. For the entire month, consisting of 30 days, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would visit 5 days, Paramananda Puri 5 days, Sarvabhaumadhar 4 days, and the other 8 sannyasis 2 days each. In this way, the 30 days of the month were completed. Text 197. Quote, if all the sannyasis came together, it would not be possible for me to pay them proper respects. Therefore, I would be an offender. Text 198. Quote, sometimes you will come alone to my place, and sometimes you will be accompanied by Sarvabhaumadhar. End quote. Text 199. Having this arrangement confirmed by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the Bhattacharya became very glad and immediately invited the Lord to his house on that very day. Text 200. Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya's wife was known as the mother of Shakti. She was a great devotee of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. She was affectionate like a mother. Text 201. After returning to his home, Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya gave orders to his wife, and his wife, known as Shatira Mata, the mother of Shati, began cooking with great pleasure. Text 202. At Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya's house, there was always a full stock of food. Whatever spinach, vegetables, fruit, and so on were required, he collected and brought back home. Text 203. Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya personally began to help his wife cook. His wife, the mother of Shati, was very experienced, and she knew how to cook nicely. Text 204. On the southern side of the kitchen were 2 rooms for offering food, and on one of them the room was offered to Shalagram Narayan. Report. Among the followers of the Vedic way, Shalagram Shila, the Vigraha of Narayan, is worshipped in the form of a stone ball. In India, every Brahmana still worships the Shalagram Shila in his home. The Vaishyas and Kshatriyas may also engage in this worship, but it is compulsory in the house of a Brahmana. Text 205. In the other room for Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's lunch. The Lord's lunch room was very secluded, and it was newly constructed by Bhattacharya. Text 206. The room was so constructed that there was only one door at an entrance from the outside for Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. There was another door attached to the kitchen, and it was through this door that the food was brought. Text 207. First, 3 manas of cooked rice, almost 6 pounds, was poured into a big banana leaf. Purport. This is the beginning of a description of the food prepared for Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. This description is given by Kaviraj Goswami, who, it is assumed, was an expert cook who knew how to prepare and how to serve food. Text 208. Then the whole stack of rice was mixed with so much yellowish and fragrant clarified butter that it began to overflow the leaf. Text 209. There was a number of pots made of the bark of banana trees and the leaves of the kea plant. These pots were filled with various cooked vegetables and placed on all sides of the leaf. Text 210. There were about 10 kinds of spinach, a soup called shukta, which was made with bitter nimba tree leaves, a pungent preparation made with black pepper, a mild cake made of fried curd, and buttermilk mixed with small fried pieces of dal. Text 211. There were preparations of dungda tumbi, dungda kushmanda, vishara, lapra, mochagata, mochagabaja, and other vegetables. Text 212. There were unlimited quantities of vrida kushmanda badi, phula badi, fruits, and various roots. Text 213. Other preparations included eggplant mixed with newly grown nimba leaves fried together, light badi, fried patola, and fried rounds of squash and pumpkin. Text 214. There was a soup made with fried urdal and mung dal, defeating nectar. There were also sweet chutney and 5 or 6 kinds of sour preparations, beginning with badamla. Text 215. There were bharats made of mung dal, of urd dal, and sweet bananas, and there was sweet rice cake, coconut cake, and various other cakes. Text 216. There were katabaja, dugda chida, dugda lak laki, and various cakes which I am unable to describe. Text 217. Sweet rice mixed with ghee was poured into an earthen pot and mixed with kanpakala, condensed milk, and mango. Text 218. Other preparations included a very delicious churned curd and a variety of sandesh sweetmeats. Indeed, all the edible various eatables available in Bengal and Orissa were prepared. Text 219. Thus, Bhattacharya prepared a great variety of food and spread a fine cloth over a white wooden platform. Text 220. On 2 sides of the stack of food were pitchers filled with scented cold water. The flowers of the tulsi tree were placed above the mound of rice. Text 221. Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya then also included several types of food that had been offered to Lord Jagannath. This included sweet balls known as Amrita Guptika, sweet rice, and cake. All these were kept separately. Purport. Although the remnants of food left by Jagannath were brought to Bhattacharya's house, they were kept separate from the preparations which had been made at his home. It sometimes happened that prasad is mixed with larger quantity of food and then distributed, but in this case we find that Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya kept the Jagannath prasad separate. He kept it aside particularly for the satisfaction of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Text 222. When everything was ready, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came there alone after finishing his midday duties. He knew the heart of Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya. Text 223. After Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya washed the Lord's feet, the Lord entered the room to take his lunch. Text 224. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was a little astonished to see the gorgeous arrangement, and gesturing, he spoke to Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya. Text 225. Quote, "This is most uncommon. How was this arrangement of rice and vegetables finished within 6 hours? Text 226. Quote, "Even 100 men cooking from 100 ovens could not possibly finish all these preparations within so short of time." Text 227. I hope the food has already been offered to Krishna, since I see there are tulsi flowers over the plates. Text 228. Quote, you are most fortunate and your endeavor is successful, for you have offered such wonderful food to Radha Krishna. Text 229. The color of the rice is so attractive and its aroma so good that it appears Radha and Krishna have directly taken it. Text 230. My dear Bhattacharya, your fortune is very great. How much shall I praise you? I'm also very fortunate to be able to take the remnants of this food. Text 231. Take away Krishna's sitting place and put it aside. Then give me prasad on a different plate. Text 232. Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya said, quote, it is not so wonderful, my lord. Everything has been made possible by the energy and mercy of he who will eat the food. Text 233. Quote, my wife and I did not especially exert ourselves in the cooking. He by whose power the food has been prepared knows everything. Text 234. Quote, now please sit in this place and take your lunch. End quote. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu replied, this place is worshipable because it was used by Krishna. End quote. Purport. According to etiquette, things used by Krishna should not be used by anyone else. Similarly, things used by the spiritual master should not be used by anyone else. That is etiquette. Whatever is used by Krishna or the spiritual master is worshipable. In particular, their eating and sitting places should not be used by anyone else. A devotee must be very careful to observe this. Text 235. Bhattacharya said, both the food and the sitting place are the Lord's mercy. If you can eat the remnants of the food, what is the offense in your sitting in this place? Text 236. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu then said, quote, yes, you have spoken correctly. The Shastras enjoin that the devotee can partake of everything left by Krishna. Text 237. Quote, my dear Lord, the garlands, scented substances, garments, ornaments, and other such things that have been offered to you may later be used by your servants. By partaking of these things and eating the remnants of food you have left, we will be able to conquer the illusory energy. End quote. Purport. This is a quotation from Srimad Bhagavatam 11.4.46. In the Hare Krishna movement, the chanting of the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, the dancing in ecstasy, and the eating of the remnants of food offered to the Lord are very, very important. One may be illiterate or incapable of understanding the philosophy, but if he partakes of these three items, he will certainly be liberated without delay. This verse was spoken by Uddhava to Lord Krishna. This was during the time when the Uddhava Gita was spoken. At that time, there were some disturbances in Dwarka, and Lord Krishna had to leave the material world and enter the spiritual world. Uddhava could understand the situation, and he talked with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The verse quoted above is an excerpt from their conversations. Sri Krishna's pastimes in the material world are called Prakata Lila, unmanifested pastimes, and his pastimes in the spiritual world are called Aprakata Lila, unmanifested pastimes. By unmanifested, we mean that they are not present before our eyes. It is not that Lord Krishna's pastimes are unmanifest. They are going on exactly as the sun is going on perpetually, but when the sun is present before our eyes, we call it daytime, manifest, and when it is not present, we call it night, unmanifest. Those who are above the jurisdiction of day, of night, are always in the spiritual world, whereas the Lord's pastimes are constantly manifest to them, as the Brahma Samhita confirms. Ananda Chinmaya Rasa Pratitavidabi Tabir Yaeva Nijaruptaya Kalabi Goloka Evanas Niva Shati Akilatma Bhuta Govinda Madi Purusham Tamham Jami Paramanjana Charita Bhakti Vilochanena Sandasa Raiva Radiesha Vilokiyanti Yam Shamasundara Machintya Grasarupam Govinda Madi Purusham Tamham Jami. Quote, I worship Govinda, the primeval Lord, who resides in his own realm, Goloka, with Radha, who resembles his own spiritual figure and who embodies the ecstatic potency, Ladini. Their companions are her confidants, who embody extensions of her bodily form and who are imbued and permeated with ever-blissful spiritual rasa.
I worship Govinda, the primeval Lord, who is Shyamasundar, Krishna himself, with inconceivable, innumerable attributes, whom the pure devotees see in their heart of hearts with the eye of devotion, tinged with the salve of love. End quote. Brahma Samhita 5:37-38. Text 238. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu then said, quote, there is so much food here that it is impossible to eat. Bhattacharya replied, quote, I know how much you can eat. Text 239. Quote, after all, at Jagannath Puri, you eat 52 times a day, and each time you eat hundreds of buckets filled with prasad. Text 240. Quote, at Dwarka, you keep 16,000 queens and 16,000 palaces. Also, there are 18 mothers and numerous friends and relatives of the other dynasty. Text 241. In Vrindavan, you also have your father's elder brother, your father's younger brother, maternal uncles, husbands of your father's sisters, and many cowherd men. There are also cowherd boyfriends, and you eat twice a day, morning, evening, in the house of each and every one. Purport. In Dwarka, Lord Krishna had 18 mothers, like Devaki, Rohini, and others. Besides these, there was his foster mother, Yasoda, in Vrindavan. Lord Krishna also had two uncles, who were brothers of Nanda Maharaj, as stated by Srila Rupa Goswami in his Sri Krishna Ganadesh Deepika, Upanando Binandascha Prithivyo Purva Jo Prithu. The elder brothers of Nanda Maharaj were Upananda and Abhinanda. Similarly, in the same book, the names of the younger brothers of Nanda Maharaj were given. Vrio tu Kalinyam Sho Satyam Sananda Nandano. Sananda and Nandana, or Sunanda and Pandava, were the younger brothers of Krishna's father, Nanda Maharaj. End quote. Sri Krishna's maternal uncles were therefore described there. Yashodhara, Yasodeva, Sudeva Dyas tu Matula. Quote, Yasodeva and Sudeva were the maternal uncles of Krishna. End quote. Krishna's uncles are also mentioned. Mana Nila Shul Nilas Cha Ramanav Etayo Kramat. Mana Lila and Sunila are the husbands of Krishna's aunts. End quote. Text 240 or 242. Quote, indeed, Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya continued, at the Govardhan Pooj ceremony, you ate stacks of rice. In comparison to that, this small quantity is not even a morsel for you. Text 243. Quote, you are the Supreme Personality of Godhead, whereas I am a most insignificant living being. Therefore, you may accept a little quantity of food from my house. Text purport. A sannyasi is expected to collect it. A little food from each and every householder. That is to say, he should take whatever he requires to eat. This system is called madukari. The word madukari comes from the word madukara and means, quote, honey collecting bees, end quote. Bees collect a little honey from each flower, but all these small quantities of honey accumulate to become a beehive. Sannyasis should collect a little from each and every householder and should eat simply what is necessary to maintain the body. Being a sannyasi, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu could collect a little food from the house of Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, and this was the Bhattacharya's request. Compared to the food eaten by the Lord on other occasions, Bhattacharya's feast was not even a morsel. This is what Bhattacharya is pointing out to the Lord. Text 244. Hearing this, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu smiled and sat down to eat. Bhattacharya, with great pleasure, first offered him the prasad from the Jagannath temple. Text 245. At this time, Bhattacharya had a son-in-law named Amoga, who was the husband of his daughter named Sati. Although born of an aristocratic Brahmana family, this Amoga was a great fault finder and blasphemer. Text 246. Amoga wanted to see Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu eat, but he was not allowed to enter. Indeed, Bhattacharya guarded the threshold of his house with a stick in his hand. Text 247. However, as soon as Bhattacharya became distributing prasad and was a little inattentive, Amboga came in. Seeing the quantity of food, he began to blaspheme. Text 248. This much food is sufficient to satisfy 10 or 20 men, but this sannyasi alone is eating so much. Text 249. As soon as Amoga said this, Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya turned his eyes upon him. Seeing Bhattacharya's attitude, Amoga immediately left. Text 250. Bhattacharya ran after him to strike him with a stick, but Amoga fled so fast that Bhattacharya could not catch him. Text 251. Bhattacharya then began to curse and call his son-in-law ill names. When Bhattacharya returned, he saw that Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was laughing to hear him criticize Amoga. Text 252. When Sati's mother, Bhattacharya's wife, heard of this incident, she immediately began to strike her head and chest, saying again, quote, "Let Sati become a widow," end quote. Text 253. Seeing the lamentation of both husband and wife, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu tried to pacify them. According to their desire, he ate the prasad and was very satisfied. Text 254. After Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu finished eating, Bhattacharya washed his mouth, hands, and legs and offered him flavored spices, tulsi manjari, cloves, and cardamom. Text 255. Then Bhattacharya placed a flower garland over Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and smeared his body with sandalwood pulp. After offering obeisances, the Bhattacharya submitted the following humble statement. Text 256. Quote, "I brought you to my home just to have you blasphemed. This is a great offense. Please excuse me. I beg your pardon," end quote. Text 257. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, "What Amoga has said is correct, therefore it is not blasphemy. What is your offense?" End quote. Text 258. After saying this, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu left and returned to his residence. Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya also followed him. Text 259. Falling down at the Lord's lotus feet, Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya said many things in self-reproach. The Lord then pacified him and sent him back to his home. Text 260. After returning to his home, Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya consulted with his wife, the mother of Shati. After personally condemning himself, he began to speak as follows. Text 261. Quote, If the man who blasphemed Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is killed, his sinful action may be atoned. End quote. Purport. The Hari Bhakti Vilas cites the following quotation from Skanda Purana concerning the blasphemy of a Vaishnava. Yohi Bhagavan Lokam Upahasham Nipotama Karoti Tasya Nashanti Ata Dharma Shashastata Nindam Kurvanti Ye Mudhap Vaishnavan Nam Mahatmanam Patanti Pritibir Sardam Maharorava Samnite Hanti Nindati Vaidveshti Vaishnavam Nabit Nandati Kurdyate Yatiho Harsham Darshane Patanani Sat. In this conversation between Markandeya and Bhagirat, it is said, quote, "My dear king, if one derides an exalted Vaishnava, he loses the results of his pious activities, his opulence, his reputation, and his sons. Vaishnavas are all great souls. Whoever blasphemes them falls down into the hell known as Maharaurava. He is also accompanied by his forefathers. Whoever kills or blasphemes a Vaishnava, and whoever is envious of a Vaishnava or angry with him, or whoever does not offer him obeisances or feel joy upon seeing a Vaishnava, certainly falls into a hellish condition." End quote. The Hari Bhakti Vilas 10.3.14 also gives the following quotation from the Dvarka Mahatmya. Kara patrais chapal yante shurtivair yama shashanai nindam kurvanti ye papa vaishnavanam mahatmanam. Quote, in a conversation between Prahlad Maharaj and Bali Maharaj, it is said, quote, "Those sinful people who blaspheme Vaishnavas, who are all great souls, are subjected very severely to the punishment offered by Yamaraj," end quote. In the Bhakti Sandarbha 313, there is a statement concerning the blasphemy of the Lord Vishnu. Ye nindati Rishikesham tat bhaktam punya rupinam sata janmarjitam punyam tesham nasyati nishchitam te pashyanti mahagore kumbi pake bayang nake bakshita kita sangena yachvach chandra divakaro shi vishnor avamanadad guru taram shi vaishnavo lang ganam tadiya dushakajanan napashat arpashyet purushadanam mam Tai sadhaman sadham vanchakat janai saha vasham nakarayet. Quote, one who criticizes Lord Vishnu and his devotees loses all the benefits accrued in 100 pious births. Such a person rots in the Kumbhipaka hell and is bitten by worms as long as the sun and moon exist. One should therefore never even see the face of a person who blasphemes Lord Vishnu and his devotees. Never try to associate with such persons. End quote. In his Bhakti Sandarbha 265, Jiva Goswami further quotes from Srimad Bhagavatam 10.74.40, Nindam Bhagavata Srinvan Tat Prasya Janasyasva Tato Nipaita Yasopi Yati adha shrikrichachrita. Quote, if one does not immediately leave upon hearing the Lord or the Lord's devotee blasphemed, he falls down from devotional service. End quote. Similarly, Lord Shiva's wife Sati states in Srimad Bhagavatam 4.4.17, Karno pibhaya nirayad yat akalpa eshe dharma vittari ashnirbir Nirbir Asyamane Chindyat Prasahya Rushatim Asatim Prabhuschej Jivham Asun Api Tato Vrijyet Sadharma. Quote, if one hears an irresponsible person blaspheme the master and controller of religion, he should block his ears and go away if he is able to punish him. But if one is able to kill, then one should, by force, cut out the blasphemer's tongue and kill the offender, and after that, he should give up his own life. End quote. Text 262. Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya continued, quote, or if I give up my own life, the sinful action may be atoned. However, neither of these ideas are befitting because both bodies belong to brahmanas. Text 263. Quote, instead, I shall never see the face of that blasphemer. I reject him and give up his relationship. I shall never speak his name. Text 264. Inform my daughter Sati to abandon her relationship with her husband because he has fallen down. When the husband falls down, it is the wife's duty to relinquish the relationship. Purport. Srila Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya considered that if a moga were killed, one would suffer their sinful reactions for killing the body of a brahmana. For the same reason, it would have been undesirable for Bhattacharya to commit suicide because he also was a brahmana. Since neither course could be accepted, Bhattacharya decided to give up his relationship with a moga and never see his face. As far as killing the body of a brahmana is concerned, Srimad Bhagavatam 1753 gives the following injunction. Shri Bhagavan Udvacha, Brahma Bandur, Nahantavya Tatayi Vadharhana Mayavo Bayaman Natam Paripahi Anushashanam. Quote, the personality of Godhead Krishna said, a friend of a brahmana is not to be killed, but if he is an aggressor, he must be killed. All these rulings are in the scriptures, and you should act accordingly. End quote. Quoting from the Shrimati, Srila Sridhar Swami comments on this quotation from Srimad Bhagavatam. Atatayinam ayantam api vedanta paragam jigham santam jigham shiyan na tena brahma bhavet. Quote, even though an aggressor may be very learned scholar in Vedanta, he should be killed because of his envy of killing others. In such a case, it is not sinful to kill a brahmana. End quote. It is also stated in Srimad Bhagavatam 1757, Vapanam dradivandinam stanam nirapanam tata esha hi brahma bandunam vadho nanyo shidadika. Quote, cutting the hair from his head, depriving him of his wealth, and driving him from his residence are prescribed punishments for the relatives of a brahmana. There is no injunction for killing the body. End quote. Such punishment is sufficient for a Brahma Bandhu. There is no need to personally kill his body. As far as Sati, the daughter of Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, was concerned, she was advised to give up her relationship with her husband. Concerning this, the Srimad Bhagavatam 5.5.18 states, Napatis chasasan nat mochiyat ya samupeta mrityam. Quote, one cannot be a husband if he cannot liberate his dependents from inevitable death. End quote. If a person is not in Krishna consciousness and bereft of spiritual power, he cannot protect his wife from the path of repeated birth and death. Consequently, such a person cannot be accepted as a husband. A wife should dedicate her life and everything to Krishna for further advancement in Krishna consciousness. If she gives up her connection with her husband, who abandons Krishna consciousness, she follows in the footsteps of Dvijapatni, the wives of the brahmanas who are engaged in performing sacrifices. The wife is not to be condemned for cutting off such a relationship. In this regard, Sri Krishna states in Srimad Bhagavatam 10.23.31 and 32, Patayo nab yashu renyan priti bharati sutadeya lokas chavo mayopeta deva apti naman anumanvate na pritaye nurageya hi anga sango nrinam iha tanmano mayi yunjaya achiran mam avapastayata. Such a separation is never condemned by the supreme will, nor should one be envious of the order of Krishna. Even demigods support such action. In this material world, one does not become beloved simply by maintaining a bodily relationship. However, one can attain complete perfection by associating in Krishna consciousness. Text 265. Quote, when a husband is fallen, his relationship must be given up. End quote. Purport. This is a quotation from Shrimati Shastra, as stated in Srimad Bhagavatam 7.11.28. Sanusta Lolupa Daksha Dharmagya Priya Shatyavak Aparmata Suchi Shnigda Patim Tva Pititam Bajet. Quote, a wife who is satisfied, who is not greedy, who is expert and knows religious principles, who speaks what is dear and truthful, is not bewildered, who is always clean and affectionate, should be very devoted to her husband, and who is not fallen. Text 266. That night, Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya's son-in-law fled, and in the morning he immediately fell sick with cholera. Text 267. When Bhattacharya heard that Amoga was dying of cholera, he thought, quote, it is the favor of providence that he is doing what I want to do. Text 268. When one offends the Supreme Personality of Godhead, karma immediately takes effect, end quote. After saying this, he recited two verses from revealed scripture. Text 269. Quote, what we have had to arrange with great endeavor by collecting elephants, horses, chariots, and infantry soldiers has already been accomplished by the Gandharvas.
Purport. This is a quotation from the Mahabharata Vanaparva 241.15. Bhimasen made this statement when all the Pandavas were lying incognito. At that time, there was a fight between the Kauravas and the Gandharvas. The Kaurava soldiers were under the command of Karna, but the commander-in-chief of the Gandharvas was able to arrest all the Kauravas by virtue of superior military strength. At that time, Duryodhana's ministers and commanders who were living in the forest requested Maharaj Yudhisthira for help. After being thus petitioned, Bhimasen spoke the verse given above, remembering Duryodhana's former nefarious and atrocious activities against them. Bhimasen felt it very fitting that Duryodhana and his company were arrested. This could have been accomplished by the Pandavas only with great endeavor. Text 270. Quote, when a person mistreats great souls, his lifespan, opulence, reputation, religion, possessions, and good fortune are all destroyed. Purport. This is a statement made by Shukadev Goswami, who was relating Srimad Bhagavatam 10.4.46 to Maharaj Prickett. The quotation concerns the attempted killing of Krishna's sixth sister, Yogamaya, who appeared before Krishna's birth as the daughter of Mother Yashoda. This daughter, Yogamaya, and Krishna were born simultaneously, and Vasudev replaced Krishna by taking Yogamaya away. When she was brought to Mathura and Kamsa attempted to kill her, Yogamaya slipped out of her hands. She could not be killed. She then informed Kamsa about the birth of his enemy, Krishna, and being thus baffled, Kamsa consulted his associates, who were all demons. When this big conspiracy was taking place, this verse was spoken by Shukadev Goswami. He points out that a demon can lose everything because of his nefarious activities. The word mamad atikrama, meaning, quote, envy of Lord Vishnu and his devotees, end quote, is significant in this verse. The word mahat indicates a great personality, a devotee of this, or the supreme personality of Godhead himself. Being always engaged in the Lord's service, the devotees themselves are as great as the supreme personality of Godhead. The word mahat is also explained in Bhagavad Gita 9.13, mahatmanastu mam partha divim prakritamasada bhajati mananasnanya manaso yatva bhutidim avyam. Quote, O son of Prita, those who are not deluded, the great souls, are under the protection of the divine nature. They are fully engaged in devotional service because they know me as the supreme personality of Godhead, original and inexhaustible. End quote. Being envious of the Lord and his devotees is not at all auspicious for a demon. By such envy, a demon loses everything considered beneficial. Text 271. At this time, Gopinathacharya went to see Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and the Lord asked him about the events taking place in Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya's house. Text 272. Gopinathacharya informed the Lord that both the husband and wife were fasting and that their son-in-law, Amoga, was dying of cholera. Text 273. As soon as Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu heard that Amoga was going to die, he immediately ran to him in great haste. Placing his hand on Amoga's chest, he spoke as follows. Text 274. Quote, the heart of the Brahmana of a Brahmana is by nature very clean, therefore it is a proper place for Krishna to sit. Text 275. Why have you allowed jealousy to sit there also? Because of this, you have become like a chandala, the lowest of men, and you have also contaminated a most purified place, your heart. Text 276. Quote, however, due to the association of Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, all your contamination is now vanquished. When a person's heart is cleansed of all contamination, he is able to chant the Mahamantra Hare Krishna. Text 277. Therefore, Amoga, get up and chant the Hare Krishna Mahamantra. If you do so, Krishna will unfailingly bestow mercy upon you. Purport. The absolute truth is realized in three phases: impersonal Brahman, Paramatma, and the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Bhagavan. All of these are one and the same truth, but Brahman, Paramatma, and Bhagavan constitute three different features. Whoever understands Brahman is called a Brahmana, and when a Brahmana engages in the Lord's devotional service, he is called a Vaishnava. Unless one comes to understand the Supreme Personality of Godhead, his realization of impersonal Brahman is imperfect. A Brahmana can chant the Hare Krishna mantra on the platform of Nambas, but not on the platform of the pure vibration. When a Brahmana engages in the Lord's service, fully understanding his eternal relationship, His devotional service is called Abhideya. When one attains that stage, he is called a Bhagavat or Vaishnava. This indicates that he is free from contamination and material attachment. This is confirmed by Bhagavad Gita 7:28. Yesham Tvantagatam Papam Jananam Punya Karmanam Te Dvandva Mohanir Mukta Bhadnate Mam Dridavrata. Quote, persons who have acted piously in previous lives and in this life, whose sinful actions are completely eradicated and who are free from the duality of delusion, engage themselves in my service with determination. End quote. A brahmana may be a very learned scholar, but this does not mean that he is free from material contamination. A brahmana's contamination, however, is in the mode of goodness. In the material world, there are three modes are goodness, passion, and ignorance, and all of these are simply different gradations of contamination. Unless a brahmana transcends such contamination and approaches the platform of unalloyed devotional service, he cannot be accepted as a Vaishnava. An impersonalist may be aware of the impersonal Brahman feature of the Absolute Truth, but his activities are on the impersonal platform. Sometimes he imagines a form of the Lord, Saguna Upashana, but such an attempt is never successful in helping one attain complete realization. The impersonalist may consider himself a brahmana and may be situated in the mode of goodness, but nonetheless he is conditioned by one of the modes of material nature. This means that he is not yet liberated, for liberation cannot be attained unless one is completely free from the modes. In any case, the Mayavad philosophy keeps one conditioned. If one becomes a Vaishnava through proper initiation, he automatically becomes a brahmana. There is no doubt about it. The Garuda Purana confirms this. Brahmana nam shaha shebya satra yaji vishishite satra yaji shashre bya sarva vedanta paraga sarva vedanta vitkotya Vishnu bhakto vishishyate. Quote, out of many thousands of brahmanas, one may become qualified to perform yoga. Out of many thousands of such qualified brahmanas, one may be fully aware of the Vedanta philosophy. Of many millions of learned Vedanta scholars, there may be one Vishnu Bhakta or devotee of Lord Vishnu. It is he who is most exalted. End quote. Unless one is a fully qualified brahmana, he cannot advance in spiritual science. A real brahmana is never envious of Vaishnavas. If he is, he is considered an imperfect neophyte. Impersonalist brahmanas are always opposed to Vaishnava principles. They are envious of Vaishnavas because they do not know the goal of life. Nate vidu sarvagatim vishnum. However, when a brahmana becomes a Vaishnava, there is no duality. If a brahmana does not become a Vaishnava, he certainly falls down from the brahmana platform. This is confirmed by Srimad Bhagavatam 11.5.3. Na bhajanti abhijanati shtanad brihastipatani yada. We can actually see that in this age of Kali, so many so-called brahmanas are envious of Vaishnavas. The Kali-contaminated brahmanas consider deity worship to be imaginative. Archie Vishnu Siladir Gurushu Naramatir Vaishnave Jatibuddhi. Such a contaminated brahmana may superficially imagine a form of a lord, but actually he considers the deity in the temple to be made of wood or stone. Similarly, such a contaminated brahmana considers the guru to be an ordinary human being, and he objects when a Vaishnava is created by the Krishna consciousness movement. Many so-called brahmanas attempt to fight us, saying, quote, how can you create a brahmana out of a European or American? A brahmana can be born only in a brahmana family, end quote. They do not consider that this is never stated in any revealed scripture. It is specifically stated in Bhagavad Gita 4.13, Chaturvarnyam Yashtam Guna Karma Vibhagasa, quote, according to the three modes of material nature and the work ascribed to them, the four divisions of human society were created by me, end quote. Thus a brahmana is not created or not a result of the caste system. He becomes a brahmana only by qualification. Similarly, a Vaishnava does not belong to a particular caste. Rather, his designation is determined by the rendering of devotional service. Text 278. After hearing this, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu After hearing Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and being touched by him, a moga who was on his deathbed immediately stood up and began to chant the holy name of Krishna. Thus, he became mad with ecstatic love and began to dance emotionally. Text 279. While a moga danced in ecstatic love, he manifested all the ecstatic symptoms, trembling, tears, jubilation, trance, perspiration, and faltering voice. Seeing these waves of ecstatic emotion, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu began to laugh. Text 280. A moga then fell before the Lord's lotus feet and submissively said, quote, O merciful Lord, please excuse my offense, end quote. Text 281. Not only did a moga beg the Lord's pardon, but he also began slapping his own cheeks, saying, quote, by this mouth I have blasphemed you, end quote. Text 282. Indeed, a moga continued slapping his face over and over until his cheeks were swollen. Finally, Gopinath Acharya stopped him by catching hold of his hands. Text 283. After seeing this, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu pacified a moga by touching his body and saying, quote, you are the object of my affection because you are the son-in-law of Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya. Text 284. Everyone in Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya's house is very dear to me, including his maid and servants and even his dog. What to speak of his relatives? Text 285. A moga, always chant the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra and do not commit any further offenses. End quote. After giving a moga this instruction, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went to Sarvabhauma's house. Text 286. Upon seeing the Lord, Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya immediately caught hold of his lotus feet. The Lord also embraced him and sat down. Text 287. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu pacified Sarvabhauma, saying, quote, after all, Amoga, your son-in-law, is a child. So what is his fault? Why are you fasting and why are you angry? Text 288. Quote, just get up and take your bath and go see the face of Lord Jagannath. Then return here and eat your lunch. In this way, I shall be happy. Text 289. I shall stay here until you return to take Lord Jagannath's remnant for your lunch. Text 290. Catching hold of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's lotus feet, Bhattacharya said, quote, why did you bring Amoga back to life? It would have been better had he died. End quote. Text 291. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, quote, Amoga is a child and your son. The father should not take the faults of his son seriously, especially when he is maintaining him. Text 292. Now that he has become a Vaishnava, he is offenseless. You can bestow your mercy upon him without hesitation. End quote. Text 293. Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya said, quote, please go, my lord, to see Lord Jagannath. After taking my bath, I shall go there and then return. Text 294. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu then told Gopinath, stay here and inform me when Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya has taken his prasad. End quote. Text 295. After saying this, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went to see Lord Jagannath. Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya completed his bath, went to see Lord Jagannath, and then returned to his house to accept food. Text 296. Thereafter, Amoga became an unalloyed devotee of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He danced in ecstasy and peacefully chanted the holy name of Lord Krishna. Text 297. In this way, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu performed his various pastimes. Whoever sees them or hears of them becomes truly astonished. Text 298. Thus, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu enjoyed eating in Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya's house. Within that one pastime, many wonderful pastimes were manifest. Text 299. These are the peculiar characteristics of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's pastimes. Thus, the Lord ate in Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya's house, and in this way, Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya's love for the Lord has become very well known. Purport. As stated in the Shaka Nirnayamrita, Amoga Panditam Bande Sri Garangatmas Satkritam Prema Gadgada Sandrag Nigam Pula Kakula Vigarham. Quote, I offer my obeisances unto Amoga Pandit, who was accepted by Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. As a result of this acceptance, he was always merged in ecstatic love, and he manifested ecstatic symptoms such as choking of the voice and standing of the hairs on his body, end quote. Text 300. Thus I have related the ecstatic love of Sarvabhauma's wife, who is known as the mother of Sati. I've also related Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's great mercy, which he manifested by excusing Amoga's offense. He did so due to Amoga's relationship with a devotee. Purport. Amoga was an offender because he blasphemed the Lord. As a result, he was about to die of cholera. Amoga did not receive an opportunity to be freed from all offenses after being attacked by the disease, but Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya and his wife were very dear to the Lord. Because of their relationship, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu excused Amoga. Instead of being punished by the Lord, he was saved by the Lord's mercy. All this was due to the unflinching love of Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya for Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Externally, Amoga was Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya's son-in-law, and he was being maintained by Sarvabhauma. Consequently, if Sarvabhauma were not excused, his punishment would have directly affected Sarvabhauma. Amoga's death would have indirectly brought about the death of Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya. Text 301. Whoever hears these pastimes of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu with faith and love will attain the shelter of the Lord's lotus feet very soon. Text 302. Praying at the lotus feet of Sri Rupa and Sri Raghunath, always desiring their mercy, I, Krishnadas, narrate Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, following in their footsteps. Thus end the Bhaktivedanta purport to Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita Madhya Lila 15th chapter describing the Lord's eating at the house of Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya.